Hello, everybody. I'm very happy to join this nice event and to have the virtual opportunity to stay in touch with the beloved diving community. I'm Laura Marroni from Italy. I'm the vice president of Dan Europe, and my main duty at Dan Europe is to oversee pretty much all the operations, and in particular, all the operations concerning insurance services and assistance services. And besides that, I'm a very passionate diver. I started diving when I was a kid and I never stopped. Now I'm a diving instructor and a very passionate technical and cave diver. So I think, like all of you, I'm looking forward to having the possibility to travel again the world and having more and more diving adventures. Today, I'm going to present you a dive accident report from Dan Europe. Those of you who know Divers Alert Network, most known as Dan, know that Dan is an organization, a not-for-profit organization that provides medical assistance services and management of diving emergencies all around the world. And so we do collect a lot of data and statistics. And so today I'm going to give you a very high-level overview about these statistics. And I'm going to share my screen now to show you a little presentation. So here we are. Okay, so as I said, this presentation is about the data that belong to Dan Europe. There are also other Dan organizations around the world. There's Dan America, there's Dan Asia Pacific, and we all have our own reports about dive accidents. During these weeks, these days, we are actually working with our colleagues to build a global report that will then be shared on all the Dan websites. So for those of you who are interested, I invite you to stay tuned on our media to get access to the full global report as soon as it's ready. Today, we are going to have a look at the dive accidents that we registered on our database in 2019, but before we do that, I wanted to show you, to give an idea of the numbers that we manage during the years. So you can see here that in 2019, there was a small peak in the number of total cases that we managed, and I'm only talking about dive accidents, because we also provide assistance for non-diving accidents abroad when people travel. But these are not included in this presentation, mainly for a time reason. So in 2018, we managed 1,099 dive emergencies. In 2019, over 1,300. Now, since the beginning of Dan operations, these numbers didn't really vary a lot. So we always manage something around 1,000 cases every year, and almost the same for non-diving emergencies. So a total of around 2,000 cases per year. Now, this is something that answers a question that we are always often asked. What is the most common diving emergency that our hotline has to manage, has to organize or handle? Now, it's this world is divided into two big fields, the compression sickness cases and problems concerning ears. So as you can see from this cake, the most frequent kind of emergency that we manage at the Neurop is DCS cases, the compression sickness cases. Then on second place, we have ear barotraumas with 279 cases in 2019, and also quite a few cases of ear infections. So here I'm talking about otitis of various kinds. And now let's move to some more details and also some tips that we can give you out of our experience. Now, when talking about ear and diving, you've seen from the previous slide that ear barotraumas and ear infections are the second and third most frequent cases of dive accidents that we manage. There are some very simple things and tips to keep in mind. First of all, we noticed by during the management of the emergency, so when the DAN member actually tells us what happened to bring to the final accident, we find out that it's very usual for people to deny symptoms or pain. If, for example, they are diving with a group of people, even more so if the group of people is of more experienced divers, it happens that the diver who is feeling some pain or difficulty in equalizing doesn't want to stop the group of people and so ignores the pain or symptoms and keep diving. This is something that should be avoided if we want to avoid severe issues or accidents like a barotrauma, for example. It's also quite frequent, even though most of us divers know that we shouldn't, but it happens that people dive with congestion, so with flu, with congestion on their sinuses. This is, of course, also something that should be avoided. Because, of course, it increases the possibility to have ear problems like a barotrauma. And last but not least, we should also never ignore prescribed treatments. This happens very often when, for example, we are abroad traveling on a diving holiday, we suffer from a ear infection. So we have people calling the DAN hotline because they are having pain or problems with their ear. We send them to the nearest clinic hospital to have a visit, and we find out that there's an ear infection ongoing. So there's the relative therapy to follow, which might include stopping any diving activity for some days. It's painful, not only because the ear is you're having pain on your ear, but also because you have to stop diving and you're maybe on a diving holiday. However, keep in mind that if you ignore the prescribed treatment and keep diving, the ear infection might get worse and become more painful, preventing you to dive even for a longer period. So these are things, very simple things that every diver should keep in mind. Now, moving to the compression sickness cases, on this slide, I collected the most frequent kind types of decompression sickness that we've registered. As you can see, neurological decompression sickness is the one that happens more often. There are quite a few cases of cutaneous or skin DCS. The otovestibular type kind, and the muscular skeletal. Now, these are names, and names are sometimes difficult to understand or to remember. So I summarized some of the most frequent symptoms that can be associated to these kinds of decompression sickness. So with the neurological, it affects your neurological system, of course. So you could have symptoms like tingling, numbness, the needles, you know, when you feel like needles on your skin, loss of muscular strength, so weakness, and even paralysis and loss of consciousness. So this can be, this can get quite serious. Cutaneous is probably the most known. So that's when you have symptoms like you could have cutis marmorata or skin rash, of course pain or itching, and these symptoms should never be ignored. The otovestibular one is can have symptoms like hearing loss, because of course it affects your ear, and also vertigo and nausea, and then finally we have the muscular skeletal one, where you can have problems, pain to your muscles, or articular pain, and this is a bit less frequent, as you can see from the absolute numbers here. So to sum up, 177 cases of the neurological DCS, 127 cases for the cutaneous, 57 cases the otovestibular, and 43 the musculoskeletal. Again, these are absolute numbers, so the total numbers we recorded, we managed of real emergencies in 2019. Moving to some knowledge that we want to share, and also some related tips. This is a concept that is probably quite already known in the diving community, so I'm probably not telling you something completely new, but still quite surprising. Are all DCS cases deserved? Did people really do mistakes to become sick? Well, this is a question that we've tried to answer since the beginning of our research activities. So we've been studying these issues for over 30 years now. We collected thousands of data on our database, also through specific researches that we did on the field involving volunteer divers in citizen science projects. And the answer, quite surprisingly, is that no, not all DCS cases were deserved. Actually, almost 60% of the cases can be defined as undeserved. And only slightly above 40% happened during dives where the diver did some kind of mistake. This is a study done on over 40,000 dive profiles, published on the scientific journal called Frontiers. This is the name of the publication. It's open access. We made it open access for everybody. So all those who are interested can go and have a look. We also have it like simplified and shorter on our magazine, alertdiver.eu. And that's definitely a very interesting read. So this graph shows quartiles. And it's always related to what I've just said. So to the fact that most DCS cases were undeserved. And here you can see on the black part of the graph, this represents all dives on our research database without a DCS. And here you can see that most divers dive in a quite conservative way. The numbers that you see represent the GF, the gradient factor. So very simplified, this is the level of supersaturation of our tissues. We all know that the maximum level that our body can tolerate is 100%. So we should never exceed 100%. And in fact, as you can see, on the median here, most people dive at around 70% of the maximum allowed level, which is 100%. On the blue graph, you have dives that ended up with a DCS case. And surprisingly, you can see that although there were some dives that went above the maximum limit of 100%, reaching more than that. Most divers dived in a quite conservative way. So on the median here, you will see that it's 79%, so almost 80%. So again, because I know that with all these numbers, people often get confused, especially people that are not really comfortable with playing with gradient factors. It means that we had DCS cases in dives that didn't reach the 100% supersaturation level that in theory should cause no problems. So what is the first tip that we can give to divers? Dive conservatively. If you are familiar with setting the GF on your computers, you can decrease it from the usual, like the standard setup, which would allow you to dive up until when you reach the 100% of saturation of your tissues. So you could decrease it a bit. We recommend for recreational diving 70%, but there are a lot of scientific discussion ongoing on this subject. And so I invite you, if you're interested in this subject, I invite you to follow our magazine, Alert Diver, where we have a lot of useful information on this subject, also including specific tips for technical diving. And for those of you who are less familiar with gradient factors and don't really feel like playing with the setting on your computer, or maybe use computers that don't allow you to change that setting, try to always, I mean, understand your dive computer and try to know how to set a more conservative profile. Then, moving to something definitely easier, let's say, that most divers know but often ignore, is the importance of good hydration. Some years ago, we launched a safety campaign that we brought all over Europe and also in other parts of the world, and in partnership with our colleagues at Dan America and the other Dan organizations. The name of the campaign was More Water, Less Bubbles, Why? Because through our citizen science research, so involving real divers doing real dives, we found out that better hydrated divers actually produced less bubbles. If you have less bubbles, of course, in theory, there's less chance that you will get sick, or that you will get a DCS. So this is something very simple to remember and to practice. Drink, remember to drink, especially after long airplane travels, because you see that when you are on an airplane, the air that you breathe is very dry, and so you should drink during the flight, and keep drinking before you dive. Now is, unfortunately, because of COVID, it's not really the right time for long travels, but we might find ourselves diving in cold water, because maybe we dive locally, like in the Mediterranean or in the North Sea. So we use probably a dry suit. So we invite everybody who uses a dry suit to learn how to use systems that allow you to pee during the dive, because we know that a lot of people using dry suit don't drink if they are going to do long dives, because they are afraid that they don't know how to cope with the need to urinate during the dive. So that's something we invite you to explore and to learn. And then, of course, fitness matters. This is also something that we investigated more during our research projects. And again, I invite you to read our publication that I told you about before, and that you can find on Frontiers Journal and on alertdiver.eu. We found a significant difference when analyzing the over 40,000 dive profiles that we've collected over the years. We found a significant difference in age and fat mass when comparing dives with divers producing zero bubbles and divers producing high bubble grades. So here you can see on this graph the age and the bubble grade, and you will see higher bubble grades for as much as you go, as you get older. And also the same happens with fat mass. So you will see here the slope of bubble grades increases. So you have higher bubble grades if the fat mass increases. And again, this is just another way of showing you the same concept. On the gray column, you find DCS cases. And on the black one, you will see the total number of dives without a DCS case. And here you see the age part. So divers who had the DCS problem were older than divers without any DCS. And the same happens with fat mass. And here the difference is even more evident. So more DCS cases, I mean, people who had a DCS case had a bigger fat mass compared to the other healthy divers. Now, why we are comparing age and fat mass? Because exercising constantly and frequently helps you to to keep younger somehow. We have also a lot of content explaining this concept on our media. So again, have a look at our online magazine, Alert Diver. It's open for everybody. So you will find a lot of interesting articles about this subject if you go there and have a look. Finally, cardiac, the cardiovascular part is also to be considered, which is interlinked to what I've just said. So keeping fit is important, but also having constant medical visits. So make sure you always dive. That before you dive, you have your feet to dive ready, especially for people that might have medical pre-existing conditions or people above 45 years old. This is an interesting data to keep in mind. We did a study some years ago analyzing over 900 diving deaths cases, and we found out that in 60% of the cases, people who died had symptoms of fatigue, distress, chest pain during the dive or soon after the dive. And in 56% of the cases, the autopsy showed that there was an evidence of cardiovascular disease that was probably ignored by the diver. So this is why, again, it's very important to do your medical visits and checkups. And also I invite you to have a look at the new diver medical form that we prepared in collaboration with PADI and many other doctors and scientific institutions. You can find it on the UHMS website, and it provides useful information on what you should consider from a medical point of view before you dive. The time is over, and so that's the end of my presentation. As I said, it was a short overview. We could spend hours talking about data and figures of dive accidents and relative tips and advice that we can provide you. But we have all the information readily available and open to anybody on our media channels. So feel free to go and have a look, and always remember to keep updated with these important issues, because our health is important if we want to dive safely. And remember that Dan is always at your side, and feel free to get in touch with us and with our medical team in case you have any query about it. So thank you for listening, and enjoy the rest of the show.